everybody will take your seats, we'll get started. Before we get started, I'd just like to ask everybody to silence your phones and any other electronic device you might have. Don't forget your watches. Good morning. And thank you all for being here to help us honor all those who died in service to our nation. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Cate McLoud, and I'll be the MC today. I retired from the Air Force in 2010 after 22 and a half years of service. My career field in the Air Force was financial management and comptroller, and I had the honor and good fortune of serving in bases in Germany, Japan, and all over the United States, including two tours of duty at the Pentagon and deployments to Croatia and Afghanistan. Now, it is my pleasure to welcome our Head Selectman, Dana Rice, for some opening remarks.
Thank you. And again, it is my pleasure to welcome you all here on behalf of the Board of Selectmen and all of the staff of the town of Gouldsboro. This is a great gathering, and we look forward to it each year, and it is incredibly important for this little community to get together and honor our veterans. And now I would introduce Reverend Bill Thomas for our invocation.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Would you pray with me? Father, we love you. We thank you. Lord, you are supreme. You are exalted. And Father, you're the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. Father, we exalt your name. We thank you, Lord. Because on this earth, Lord, you give us examples of your holiness, your bravery, your courage. You give us examples, Father, of your character. And Father, we find this character in those that have gone on before us, that have died, that have sacrificed. And Lord, we aspire, Father, to be the same, to sacrifice, to be courageous, to be as they were. Lord, because that's what you were. Lord, you said in your word that greater love has no man than this, than he laid down his life for his friends. And Father, that we would embody sacrifice, we would embody selflessness every day, Lord, not just one event, not just one time, but as these men and women did, Lord, for a lifetime, for eternity. Lord, we thank you for their example. We thank you for your example. And Lord, this is your day. Every day is your day. But you have ordained the life of these men and women who died in battle. Lord, they didn't die in vain. They died for a purpose. They died for a cause. And Lord, we remember them fondly because they represent you, Lord. And Father, we thank you for this country that also was created to represent you. And Father, we had attained to that again, Father, to the morals and principles that you laid out, that these men and women died for. Lord, we yearn for that, and we praise you for that. And Lord, we thank you for this example, and we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Now, if everybody would stand, we will say the Pledge of Allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As you know, Memorial Day was created to honor military personnel who lost their lives while serving our country. What we do here today is not a celebration. Our actions should not be referred to as festivities. Today's ceremony serves as a solemn reminder of the sacrifices made by those who died in service to our country, and as a chance to honor both them and the friends and families who grieve their loss. I invite you now all to stand for this national anthem.
Thank you.
Please be seated. At this time, I'm going to read some messages from our elected officials. From Governor Mills. Dear friends, I'm sorry I could not be with you in person this Memorial Day, but please know that I stand by your side in solemn remembrance of our service members who lost their lives defending our state and nation. Throughout our state's history, dedicated people have shouldered our responsibility to protect our country, stand up to defend the precious freedoms we often take for granted. Many of those people sacrificed their own lives to save ours, giving, as President Lincoln said, the last full measure of devotion. As a daughter, niece, and sister of veterans, I always mark Memorial Day with gratitude and grief. Gratitude that my loved ones came home from conflicts around the world, and grief that so many Maine service members did not. This Memorial Day, we remember the service members we have lost in defense of our great nation. We recognize the sacrifice of their families. We resolve to be the best citizens we can be, united in our pursuit of a more perfect union, a union and a dream our service members died defending. Today, Maine stands with the family members and friends grieving the loss of a loved one, and with all those who have served and continue to serve our state and nation. You have our undying gratitude this day and every day. Sincerely, Janet T. Mills, Governor. This is from Representative Golden. Dear friends, please accept my sincere gratitude and warmest wishes as you gather here today in honor of Memorial Day. The idea of America was brought to life by our founding fathers, but its survival is owed to the generations of service members who defend it at all costs. All of these brave men and women sacrificed something when they took their solemn oath. Some ultimately sacrificed everything. Memorial Day gives us an opportunity to remember those who are no longer with us, from those lost on the battlefield to others still missing in action. We lose still more every day to the invisible wounds that linger long after service. The sacrifice of each of these patriots is shared by the loved ones who continue to carry the weight of that loss. I know how heavy that burden can feel, and understand the distinct kind of courage it can take to keep putting one foot in front of the other. Let us see today as not just an opportunity to honor these neighbors, but also as a reminder of our duty to support them with our prayers and our actions. Thank you to all for their hard work to make today's ceremony a success. Thank you to all those who have served or are serving our great nation. And thanks to everyone gathered here to mark Memorial Day together. May God bless those who gave their lives for this country, and God bless America. Sincerely, Jared Golden, Member of Congress. This is from Angus King. Friends, throughout history, Americans have joined together to honor the service and sacrifice of our men and women in uniform. This Memorial Day, let us continue the sacred ritual of paying tribute to those who gave their lives to preserve and protect this great nation. Since its conception in 1866, this day has given voice to the fallen and rededicates ourselves to our principles for which they fought and died. In numerous conflicts over more than two centuries, more than a million Americans have made the ultimate sacrifice while serving our country. Today, we memorialize their patriotism, sense of duty, and courage in the face of grave peril. Around the world, our service members continue to serve on our behalf, protecting us from threats from around the globe. Their sacrifice and willingness to answer the call of duty deserve our enduring gratitude. In Maine, with our storied history of service to the nation, We are fortunate to have dedicated federal and state veteran services, including the VA, the Maine Bureau of Veterans Services. Additionally, many veteran service organizations, business leaders, and community members across the state work tirelessly to support Maine veterans and pay respect to those who made the ultimate sacrifice. This commitment is a testament to Maine's patriotism and sense of duty. So today and every day, let us reflect on the service and dedication of America's fallen and recommit ourselves to upholding the principles for which they fought and died. May God bless you, and may God bless the United States of America. Sincerely, Angus S. King, Jr., United States Senator. And finally, from Senator Susan Collins, dear friends, here in Maine and throughout our nation, Americans gather on this solemn day of gratitude as we raise our voices in song and bow our heads in prayer in honor of those who gave their all for all of us. We are reminded that freedom is a gift purchased at the greatest possible price. From America's founding to today, the men and women of our armed forces have written the history of freedom. From generation to generation, they add new and inspiring chapters of valor, devotion to duty, and sacrifice. As we honor the fallen, we also thank the families who endure the separation, the anxiety, and all too often, the grief that are part of freedom's price. The mothers and fathers, husbands and wives, sons and daughters, and brothers and sisters left behind will always have our deepest sympathy and enduring support. It is significant that a day dedicated to the deepest of human emotions, grief, remembrance, and gratitude, began not by decree from any high authority, but in the hearts of ordinary people. As the Civil War ravaged the countryside and took an ever greater and more ghastly human toll, widows and grieving mothers on both sides of the conflict began placing wildflowers on the graves of the soldiers, regardless of uniform, who fell in their fields and forests. From those humble beginnings, we have remained true to the original spirit of Memorial Day. Memorial Day is about remembrance. It is also about resolve and our commitment to uphold the values that inspire the sacrifice we honor today. This was best articulated in what many regard as the first and finest Memorial Day speech. It was given not on a warm May morning, but on a chilly November afternoon in a place called Gettysburg. These are the words of President Abraham Lincoln, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. May God bless you all, and may God bless America. Sincerely, Susan M. Collins, United States Senator. And that is actually an excellent segue into our next guest, our state representative, Billy Bob Fockingham, who will be reading the Gettysburg Address for us.
Thank you for the invitation to speak today. It is an honor to get to speak at a solemn occasion, and I do not take that lightly. I'll be reading the Gettysburg Address. I think this is one of the greatest speeches in American history, and it's very fitting, even though it was before Memorial Day took place. I think it conveys exactly what Memorial Day is about. And just to set the stage for this speech, it was in the middle of the Civil War, right almost exactly in the middle, 2 years into a four-year war. That war, we would lose around 500,000 or 600,000 men from both sides. There were battles where tens of thousands of men die in 2 or 3 days, sometimes in a single day, like Antietam. And Gettysburg is where the tide of that war turned. There were some gentlemen from Maine that lost their lives that day, and some that helped turn the tide of the war. And this speech was given on November 19th, 1863, by President Abraham Lincoln. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we have said here, but it can never be forgot what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus so far nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth. As I was laying in bed this morning, before I decided to get out, I was reflecting on Memorial Day and Memorial Days of the past. Little background, it started as dedication, Decoration Day in 1868, and that tradition continued until World War I when they started honoring the World War I dead and on through the wars until finally in 1972 Congress made it Memorial Day. And our nation, I think, for all those years has known how important it is to remember the dead and honor them on that occasion. And so I was just reflecting of how when I was a child in the Boy Scouts, we would have a parade in Winter Harbor where we'd line up from the IGA and go up to the town office. And I remember literally hundreds of people being there. And the last few years, especially the last couple decades, this whole generation really, I don't think, understands the importance of that. Look around right now. I mean, how many people of that younger generation are in here? It's sad that it's come to this. It truly should bring a tear to your eye that we're not remembering the men that sacrificed and gave to this country. And so I guess my last words would be a challenge to you that next Memorial Day you speak to people and let them know how important it is and bring them out to events like this and have a resurgence of pride in our country and remembrance of the men that had fallen. Because if it was not for what they had done, we would not be here today. Thank you.
Our guest speaker today is Larry Peterson. Let me tell you just a little bit about Larry and his career. Cryptologic Technician, Technical Master Chief Petty Officer Larry E. Peterson, U.S. Navy retired, was born in 1947 and raised in the small town of Depew, Illinois. His father was a World War II U.S. Navy veteran who served on escort carriers in the Pacific, one of which participated in the Battle of Leyte Gulf. Larry was a 23-year naval cryptologist whose service spanned the Vietnam and Cold War periods from 1966 to 1989. He led teams in signal intelligence operations as a member of the Naval Security Group Command, predecessor of Navy's elite information warfare organization. His sea duty included shipboard and submarine service, and his shore assignments were extensive on many of the world's continents. During his career, Larry received numerous medals, commendations, and awards, including the Department of Defense Meritorious Service Medal. He graduated with academic distinction from the Navy Senior Enlisted Academy and holds a Bachelor of Science degree from the University of Maryland. After retiring from the Navy, Larry was a program management professional for a defense contractor in the field of electronic warfare. As such, he managed the design, engineering, manufacturing, and installation of surveillance and weapons systems on Navy ships, submarines, and aircraft. In total, Larry spent over 40 years of continuous service to our nation. Larry met his wife Phyllis in 1971 while stationed at Naval Security Group Activity Winter Harbor, and they've been married 52 years. After his retirement from industry in 2007, they built a home in South Gouldsboro, and they've been residents here ever since. Over the years, Larry has been a volunteer participant in a number of community organizations and currently serves on the Gouldsboro Budget Committee. He spends some of his spare time pursuing photography as a serious hobby. And I'd say that's an understatement. With great pleasure, I introduce Master Chief Larry Peterson.
Thank you, Cate. And thank you to the Veterans Committee, Gouldsboro Veterans Committee, for inviting me to speak today. And while I'm at it, I want to recognize anybody here from the Peninsula School, either a teacher or a student who participated in the cleaning of our memorial out front. If anybody is here, please raise your hand or stand. Gracie? Good for you. Good for you. We're bringing them up right in Gouldsboro, Billy Bob. But I echo, and I have to strongly support what you said about the lack of participation in our patriotic programs such as today. It's not a good thing. There's another thing I wanted to make a point about. Did I bring my glasses?
I have a spare pair for one.
You stole them?
Yep.
I've got them. In the town newsletter, not everybody here gets a town newsletter. The town newsletter said that I was a strong military leader and a very strong civic leader. I am a very strong civic supporter and volunteer. There's the strong civic leader, right there. And he's been that for a long, long time. Memorial Day is the only national holiday designated by Congress for the express purpose of honoring the memory of our men and women who died while serving in the military services of the United States, particularly those who died in battle and those who died from wounds. Americans are supremely grateful for and proud of our sons and daughters who go to war in our name, and we revere and honor above all others those patriots who sacrificed their lives that we might refrain, that we might remain free. To date, they number about 1.5 million. That's a lot of souls that have given up for the sake of our country's freedom. It is impossible to know all the individual stories of our war dead, nor can I begin to describe or even comprehend the enormity of the impact of those losses and sacrifices have had on families in our country. They are incalculable, with effects that will reverberate throughout our nation for as long as it exists. We've been left bereft of the collective talents and productivity of people from many generations from the Revolution to the present. When our sons and daughters die in war, they give up all they are or all they will ever be and leave nothing to the living except their memory. These memories are sacred treasures that are bequeathed to every living American and those that are not yet born. Today, we join the rest of our great nation in remembering and honoring our fallen heroes. The will of the American people to honor our military dead is exercised through a Department of Defense agency officially charged with recovering unaccounted for personnel from past conflicts listed as either prisoners of war or missing in action, POWs and MIAs. This is a solemn obligation required by the covenant our nation has with those we sent to war. The name of the agency is the Defense POW MIA Accounting Agency, or DPAA. Their efforts are constant and ongoing, and I mean constant. As we speak somewhere, there is analysis on remains of our service people. And they are relentless in locating and recovering and identifying remains of U.S. servicemen wherever they may have fallen, so they can be interred with the honor, respect, and dignity they deserve. Almost weekly, DPAA publishes announcements of the remains of servicemen who've been recovered and identified from World War II, Korea, or Vietnam. Recovery teams often travel to faraway battlefields, even in remote locations, to do so. It wasn't that many years ago that I recall they sent a couple of teams to the Himalayas because some of the residents, the natives there, had identified aircraft wreckage, and it appeared to them to be World War II wreckage. So they contacted the American Embassy. The American Embassy contacted the DPAA, and off they went to the Himalayas. And they didn't fly to the Himalayas. They climbed them to get up to the crash sites and recovered bodies. When found, the remains are carefully removed and returned to the U.S. for laboratory analysis and identification. If the remains are identified, they're given numbers and buried in graves either in the U.S. or in cemeteries abroad that are administered by the American Battle Monuments Commission. If identified, they are either returned for burial in the U.S. or interred in U.S. cemeteries overseas. There are many, many thousands interred in overseas cemeteries, at Normandy and other places. Speaking of Normandy, the U.S. and its allies invaded Europe on 6 June 1944 to defeat Nazi Germany in the largest amphibious operation in military history. And next week, we observe the 80th anniversary of D-Day. On that day, bear with me, I choke up. I'm going to be choking up here throughout. .2501 Americans were killed on that day. During the ensuing 2-month Battle of Normandy,
A total of 29,000 Americans were killed and 105,000 wounded. Now, that pales in significance to the losses at Antietam, as Billy Bob mentioned. But it's a lot of souls again. A little over 2 weeks ago, on the 10th of May, the DPAA announced the identification of remains of two servicemen, one killed in action during the invasion itself on D-Day, and the other during the battle that followed. I received DPAA reports from the VFW, which I'm a life member of, every week or two. And these are the first, this is the first report of recovery of Normandy survivor KIAs that I've seen in a long, long time, if ever. I can't remember ever seeing any remains identified. So the first one, the one that was killed during the invasion itself, was Navy coxswain Harley E. Alexander, 22, of New Madison, Ohio. He was accounted for on March 22, 2024, a month ago. On June 8, 1944, Alexander was assigned to the destroyer USS Glennon, which struck a mine off the coast of Normandy and killed 16 sailors instantly. The majority of the crew abandoned the vessel, but Alexander and some other shipmates remained on board to try to save the ship. 2 days later, on June 10th, the Glennon was struck by multiple artillery barrages from German forces on shore and sank with all hands. Alexander's remains were not accounted for, and he was deemed non-recoverable on May 4th, 1949. In 1957, pieces of the ship were found, including human remains, which were turned over to American officials who determined the remains were of at least two unidentified individuals. They were interred on 4 March 1959 in the Ardennes American Cemetery in Belgium. The remains were exhumed in 2022, and Alexander was identified through DNA analysis. His name was originally recorded on the American Battle Monuments Commission's Wall of the Missing at Cambridge American Cemetery in Cambridge, England, along with a lot of others who were missing from World War II. So now a rosette will be placed next to his name to denote that he's been recovered and identified. The second recovery and identification was Army First Lieutenant Nathan Baskin, 28 years old, of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. In June 1944, Baskin was a platoon commander of four M10 tank destroyers. He and one of his men were scouting ahead on foot when they were ambushed by enemy troops. The other soldier was badly wounded and, believing that Baskin had been killed, escaped the firefight and made his way back to the main force. Several attempts were made to retrieve Baskin's body, but he was not found. After the war, investigators discovered that Baskin had been captured and later died at a German military hospital on 23 June 1944 and buried nearby. His remains had been commingled with those of German soldiers. Over the years, several attempts were made to separate and identify his remains, but it wasn't until late 2023, last November, I believe it was, that they were exhumed again, separated, and identified by a private U.S. laboratory using DNA analysis. Since DNA analysis has evolved and developed to be so accurate, we've had countless, thousands and thousands of MIAs and POWs whose remains have been lost all over the world, and they've been recovered and identified. The DPAA reviewed the findings of that private laboratory in early 2024, just a couple of months ago, and concurred that the remains were those of Baskin. First Lieutenant Baskin's name, again, was originally recorded on the walls of the missing at Normandy American Cemetery, an American Battle Monuments Commission site in Colville-sur-Mer and now a rosette will be placed next to his name to indicate he has been accounted for. Franklin Roosevelt said, "Those who have long enjoyed such privileges as we enjoy forget in time that men have died to win them." And again, remembering what Billy Bob said, there's a whole lot of forgetting that's been going on. Lest we here this morning forget that, I will describe the deaths of two more heroes. Who sacrificed their lives for our country. One during the recent war on terror and the other in the revolution. Senior Chief Cryptologic Technician, same outfit as me. Was born in Oswego, New York in 1983. From her earliest days, she proved to be a true Renaissance woman in every sense of the word. During her youth, she developed a wide range of talents and abilities and achieved academic excellence in the classroom, most notably in the realm of languages. A lover of horses, she even trained herself to speak Spanish so she could converse with the local stable hands. Like many others, the events of 9/11 prompted her to join the military, and in 2003, she enlisted in the U.S. Navy. After boot camp, she graduated from the Defense Language Institute in 2004 and became proficient in Arabic and numerous other languages. From there, she began a stellar career as a gifted intelligence professional, serving in intelligence and special warfare units that only the best are judged worthy to serve in. I can tell you, she was also the very first female to ever go through special operations training. Shannon proved to be a rock star in her efforts to provide and protect critical information during very challenging and perilous assignments all over the world. She was a true warrior who embodied all of the attributes the term denotes. In 2014, Shannon met and married a Green Beret warrant officer, Joseph Kent. Despite demanding lives, they became the parents of two beautiful sons, Colt and Josh. The middle names of both in honor of close friends who had been lost in combat. Being a superstar both in the intelligence world and as a wife and mother wasn't enough for Shannon. Somehow she found the time to complete both her bachelor's and master's degrees in psychology. In March 2018, she was accepted into a PhD program at the Uniformed Services University of Health Sciences. Her goal was to become a Navy psychiatrist so she could help fellow shipmates and service members better cope with PTSD. Her dream was put on hold, however, when she volunteered for another dangerous special ops assignment in Syria against ISIS. That was in 2018, November. During her time there, she was part of a highly skilled, multidisciplined, armed task force involved in critical and demanding intelligence work. On 16 January 2019, while involved in clandestine operations against ISIS in the Syrian city of Manbij, Senior Chief Kent and two others were killed by an improvised explosive device detonated by a terrorist suicide bomber. She was only 35 and she had, and her sons were 3 years old and 18 months. The results of Shannon's work can be only described as vast, meaningful, and enduring. I don't know if any of you recall this incident when she was killed. Certainly those of us who were in the Naval Security Group remember, because it was televised. Her funeral service was at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. There were thousands that showed up, Navy chiefs, by the hundreds. And it was quite a spectacle and quite an honor for that woman. So as long as individuals of her caliber, that is to say Senior Chief Shannon Kent, are willing to answer the call to duty, we can be assured that freedom and liberty will not perish, but will prevail till the end of time. Now, our fourth hero died during our first war, and this one is close to home, literally and figuratively. I shared this when I spoke in Winter Harbor a couple of years ago. It's something I'm very proud of. This man was a soldier in the Connecticut militia who was killed just a few miles from his farm during the Revolution. On September 6, 1781, British forces under the command of the traitor Benedict Arnold attacked and burned New London, Connecticut, and attacked Fort Griswold in the Groton Heights area of Groton on the opposite side of the Thames River from New London. General Arnold commanded the main force in the attack on New London and dispatched Colonel Edmund Eyer to lead a smaller force of 800 men to take Fort Griswold, which was defended by only 160 Connecticut militiamen. The British took casualties but eventually overwhelmed the fort and the militia's commander, Colonel Ledyard, who ordered his men to put down their arms to prevent further bloodshed. At that point, six of them had already been killed and 20 lay wounded. When he surrendered his sword to the British officer in command, the British officer ran Ledyard through with his own sword, and the British soldiers fell upon and massacred the disarmed Americans. When the bloodletting ended, 83 militiamen were dead and 36 wounded, some mortally. One of the wounded militiamen was Corporal Edward Mills, a Mayflower descendant and a local farmer who lived but 3 miles from the fort. Upon hearing of the impending attack on Fort Griswold, he rushed to join his comrades in its defense. All day long, the sounds of cannons could be heard throughout the area, including at the Mills farm at Candlewood Hill. And smoke could be seen rising in the distance from the fort and New London, which had already been burned virtually to the ground by then. By nighttime, the guns were silent, though, and Edward didn't return. So Hannah, his wife, dispatched his 22-year-old niece, Anna Warner, the next morning to go to the fort to find him. She rushed barefoot down the lane to the roadway that was already crowded with worried relatives of the other defenders. At the end of her 3-mile hike, she found Edward lying mortally wounded in the home of Ebenezer Avery, very near the fort. Edward was weak from loss of blood and sinking fast. He longed to see his family and begged his niece to bring them to him. So Anna hurried back to the farm, saddled an old horse, then helped up the young wife and the oldest of his 5 children while she walked beside the horse carrying the youngest child, a 3.5-week-old baby boy, Edward Jr. When they arrived at the Avery house, she placed the infant in the arms of his dying father. Corporal Mills succumbed to his wounds that day, 7 September 1781. He was 34 years old and he left a wife and 5 children. Under the age of 10, he was my 5th great-grandfather, and baby Edward Jr. was my 4th. I descend directly from him. I have visited Fort Griswold and paid homage to my great-grandfather at his grave at Whiteman Cemetery in Groton. Phyllis was with me. I also stood on the very same oaken plank floor in the very same Avery house where he bled to death 243 years ago. I stood on the floor. I looked down. You could almost see bloodstains, I swear. The Battle of Groton Heights might not have been as momentous or famous as other battles, but I assure you, the men who perished there paid as great a price as anyone and anywhere in our nation's history. I'd like to share a poem written by Colonel Louis Millette, a combat veteran of three wars. World War II, Korea, and Vietnam, and he was awarded the Medal of Honor for leading the very last bayonet charge of the Korean War. Now deceased, Colonel Millette was a native of Mechanic Falls in Androscoggin County, by the way. The title of the poem is An Old Soldier. I have fought when others feared to serve. I have gone where others failed to go. I've lost friends in war and strife who valued duty more than love of life. I've seen challenged men become even bolder. I've seen the duty, honor, sacrifice of the soldier. Now I understand the meaning of our lives, the loss of comrades not so very long ago. So do you. Who have answered duty's siren call. May God bless you, my son. May God bless you all. So in closing, please remember the names of those people that I spoke about today. These are heroes. And of all the others who've given their lives for our nation, 1.5 million, there's no way you can say the names of that many people, but you can go on to Vietnam Wall's website and read them. That's just one of the places. I'd like you also to say, in private, the names of two of my best friends, Richard Pumo and Murray Joy, who died from that war long after it was over. I went into the Navy with Dick together, my hometown buddy. We went in on the buddy plan, and he went to a ship immediately, USS Cleveland, and I went to training to be a cryptologic technician. And he was a fire control technician, and he drove Marines, or as assault boat coxswains drove the Marines inshore, he manned a twin 50 mount, clearing the VC out of the bushes, so to speak. There weren't too many bushes left, though, because they had been wiped out by Agent Orange, so the Marines could hit the beach without the fear of the bad guys lurking in the bushes. Agent Orange was a killer. Killed Dick 25 years after he served, and it killed Murray just a couple of years ago. Also remember that there are still about 80,000, give or take, soldiers, sailors, and Marines who are still missing, some of whom might have been POWs. And finally, please say a prayer for our Gold Star families who will never see or hear their loved ones again. God bless all of our fallen sons and daughters, and God bless America. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. Our program calls for the wreath laying now. Since we had to move the ceremony inside, we will do the wreath laying at the end of the ceremony. So at this time, we will have the playing of God Bless America.
Land that I love, from beside her and guide her through the night and the night from above.
What's the word?
From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans, white with foam. God bless us.
Thanks for getting us started, Larry. I would now like to call for a moment of silence, followed by the playing of taps. Reverend Thomas, if you would come and give us a benediction.
One more time, will you pray with me, please? Father, we thank you, Lord. We just stand in awe of your creation, these men and women, Lord, you set forth. We thank you, Lord, for their example. We thank you, Lord, for the reason why they died, Lord. Father, we thank you for this great nation. Lord, we need to be a thankful people. We need to be a people, Lord, that looks forward, that looks backward, that honors and respects, Lord. Father, you set up that example. You set up the system, Father. You set up your world, this earth. And Lord, you laid before us examples of honor, courage. Father, you've given us so many good gifts. And we thank you, Lord, for what you've given to us. We thank you of how it came to be. Lord, that you use men and women or to sacrifice for our behalf. Lord, we don't stand today forgetting, Lord, but we stand remembering. We stand honoring. And Lord, we stand in humility for everything we've heard. For all the examples that we've heard today, we stand in humility, Lord, realizing that we are so small and you're so mighty, Lord. And what is done before us and what has gone on before us, Lord, is so much bigger than we are. But we thank you, Father, for what they've done, for the fact that you are their God, and Lord, you are our God. And so we praise your name. But Lord, we pray that you would bless these families, bless this nation, Lord. But Father, allow us, Lord, to bless you. Allow us, Father, to honor their memory by following you, Lord, by putting those principles into practice every day and becoming once again people of honor, people of obedience to your word, and to make this nation great again. We thank you, Father, for everything we've heard today. For it's in your name we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Thomas. Once again, I want to thank all of you for coming today to pay your respects for our honored dead. Although this day is set aside as a national holiday to do just that, I ask you all to remember that every day we should respect, honor, and pray for those who have died in service to this country and those who mourn for them. And as others have said, please remember those who died not actually during their service, but after it due to suicide or a Agent Orange or anything like that. Please keep them all in your thoughts and prayers. And now we will do the wreath laying outside. So please join us for that. You okay, Larry?
Yeah.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah, done good.
Oh, yes.
You can come.
Thank you so much.
You want to take this out there? You want to take this out there, Mark?
Could you do that? Just take what it's okay. And go out there and just zoom in. You're the
okay.
Other
so this is still running.
It's still running. Yeah.
Okay.
So just don't worry. Just
good.
Put it out there. And
sure.
Hello, Phyllis.
Thank you everybody for coming. Aren't you glad we held it inside instead of out here?
Yeah, there are.
Yeah. We've got some refreshments.
There are some refreshments.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I forgot about that.
We should meet.
Looking good? Oh no.
Thank you.